I started something with you guys during the summer, and we had begun with kind of just like an introductory to kind of some of the circuits that are out, like microprocessors and different types of circuitry. And it was just an introduction, a cursory overview of the kind of things that are happening right now with education and technology with that movement. So what I would like to do is continue that talk where we left off with some circuits and some of this stuff with the Arduino. We introduced it a little. So I would like to continue that talk with you guys today and then kind of show you guys some of the things that I would envision how you would introduce it to your students. Because some of the things that we introduce, and if you look at it, when you see some of these boards, you think to yourself, you know, okay, that's cool and it looks really neat, but how would I do this with a class of fourth graders, or how would I do this with a class of fifth graders? That's my teacher, questions are asking me the same question. So I have a plan that the way I would roll this out, and I will just try to share with you guys some of my experiences that I've used. In our summer program, we do this with your guys' kids, or with Lamont's kids, I should say. And we do this every year, and we stagger it out. We scaffold the process, too. It's like, last year we tried something, this year we're going to get bigger, and then next year, you know, we continue with that idea. So to get there, we have to definitely have a plan and how to roll it out to the group. So what I want to do is just begin by saying welcome to everyone and kind of let you know that the plan for today is one that we'll start by talking about this microprocessor. We'll discuss some of the finer points of it and then introduce some of the sensors that you can use with it, and also how you can build projects around those sensors or this idea of data collection, which is really the point of this whole process. Before we actually get involved with all the rest of this, we have to kind of go over some basic vocabulary, if you will. There are different parts of this that you have all in your boxes. This first piece we set up during the summer, and if you're new with us, or maybe you didn't get a chance to attend the summer program, you may not have these like screwed into the board or taped. This little white box is like a sticky backing, and you may not have it on the back, but you can still just have these two pieces out and you can lay them into the board, and that's fine. But what you'll need right now is this. First thing is, it's a microprocessor, and what a microprocessor is, it's not a microcomputer, it's not a smaller version of a computer, but it handles jobs or tasks like a computer would, but it requires information from another device. So we will actually need to hook this into a computer, send it some instructions, some programming instruction, and then it will operate on its own. It'll just repeatedly do that instruction over and over again. So they call them microprocessors. In fact, this name is Arduino. This type of microprocessor is an Arduino. And SparkFun, the company that sells these, made their own version of an Arduino. Arduino is an Italian company. You might be asking that, like, you know, kind of sounds a funny name. It's an Italian-based company. And what was nice about Arduino was they created this microprocessor. And what they did with it was they just kind of opened up the diagrams, the wiring schematics, and they just left them out there for everyone. They said, hey, we have this really neat invention. We want everyone to share it, so we're not going to put any copyrights on it. You're welcome to go and make this same exact board on your own. So if you have the information and the know-how, you can build this at your house. And people can actually do that. Their boards aren't as difficult as you would think. A little soldering, you can make one of these yourself. Well, SparkFun, the company, which is an education tech supply company, they created this Arduino. So when I call an Arduino, I'm really talking about this red board. That's their generic version of the Arduino. So we'll need an Arduino. We'll also need this breadboard, which is this little porcelain or ceramic type of a little squared box. Bless you. You'll also need to have this USB cable. It's red. It's very identifiable. It's in your SIK, your inventor's kit. You pull that out, you'll have that ready to go.
You are too nice.
Right? I'm feeling some love in here. Okay. Next. This is separate from the SparkFun Inventors Kit. This is in your blue box. So if you have your blue box, it's in a nice bubble-wrapped container. That's fun for later. But you'll need this, and this is it's got these little metal pins that stick out of the bottom, and you'll recognize it with the white boxes that are in front. I'll give you a moment to dig into your blue box and find that. Okay, so if you have your, this is called an Arduino. It's an interface. And it's a shield, and they call them shields because they kind of just connect on top of microprocessors. Arduino had this idea of, let's build this base model and let's allow people to add extra components just simply by there's this whole process of soldering, which they didn't think was a realistic way of going about it. But shields were designed, the pins are designed to actually just line up and poke and, you know, just mount right into this. And we'll do that in a second, but just hold this in the air. Let me see that you have one in your hand. Great, I see it. Oh, you don't have to disconnect, that's fine. Just make sure that we have one. Okay, so I have an idea that most everyone has one at the table, so that's great. All right, so now, what we will do, and this is from Vernier, the company. Vernier is a scientific technologies company. They do a lot of different instruments. So they build scales, microscopes, different types of sensors for using. So typically, if you are in a high school or middle school environment, you'll hear the word Vernier tossed around because it's kind of the standard when it comes to high quality sensors and different types of scientific equipment. Vernier actually creates a lot of these types of sensors, and they have a special type of plug that will just mount right into these. So what we can do is we can go in their catalogs and buy all the different types of sensors that we're interested in using, and we can use this as a data collection device, which is what we're going to do. Now, you don't have to go this route. If this is beyond what you're interested, you can buy these, and they sell USB style ones. You actually have a temperature probe that's got a USB plug-in. And you can kind of skirt this whole idea of using an Arduino for that. But what's nice about this is what we're going to do today is we're going to learn how to use these things for home automation or to make some kind of automated system. And we'll have a further talk about that. But what I want to do is learn how to mount this onto the board, because most of you guys probably pulled it out. It's important that you mount this correctly. So what I'm going to ask you to do is just to inspect your Arduino first. You'll notice on one side it says analog. And then there's numbers 1 through, or like A1, A2, A3, A4, A5, A6. And then the other side says digital. And there's digital 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way to 13, digital 13. On this shield, the one with the pin sticking out of it, this shield actually has an A1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then a D 1 through 13 also. So what's important is that you actually put these together, with the digital side, with the digital pins. The D pins go into the digital side. And the A pins go to the analog side. So let's just make sure that, and if you want to, check with your partner. Just make sure that they also doing it the right way. And this is something that you want to do really slow. The fastest person does not win in this case. If you put these in too quick, you'll bend the pins.
Oh, man.
Uh-oh. Yeah. Okay. Great. I'm looking around and seeing that they're done. Now, some people notice that I have my power cord source on one side and then my white box is on the other side. It really just depends on how you've mounted it onto the black base. So don't try to go off of mine. Just look at your A and analog side matching up and your D and digital side matching up.
And it goes all the way in?
Yep, and you just push them until they stop, and I'll let you visually inspect mine to see that.
I'm not doing it.
So do you see how
he gave up and I gave up. We're giving up.
So do you see where the analog side and the digital side?
Yeah. It's the right way, but it's just
they actually just match up and they'll just kind of slowly, and then what you do is just in all different sides, you just kind of press it down slowly. You're fine. If you've ever put a cord into a wall socket, it's very similar to that.
Our piece of equipment.
I got you. Take your time. So while they're finishing that piece, let me talk to you guys about what I'm looking for in your blue box. This is a soil moisture sensor, and it looks like a fork. If you dig through your blue box, you'll find that soil moisture sensor. We got it. Success? Perfect. Yeah. Last time we met during the summer, I kind of introduced this, but we really kind of went through it fast. So I wanted to spend a moment and just kind of revisit this because it'll help us understand how to load the code. It's just a good review from the summer past, and also just to kind of make sure that we all understand how to make this install the program again. So it'll be a good review for that as well. So if you have that, you can go ahead and plug it in. And there's only one way it fits into this, so you can't go wrong on that. But you're going to then say, well, does it matter analog 1, 2, 3, 4, or 1, 2, or digital 1 and 2? It's an analog input. It won't fit into the digital side, even if you tried to. So it doesn't work on that side. But I would just recommend putting it into analog 1. It will recognize either one. The computer knows that it searches analog 1, searches analog 2. Whichever one sends a signal, that's the active port. But I would just keep it simple and put it into analog 1. All right, so we're about to put some power to this thing. Just check with your neighbor and make sure they have theirs set up properly as well. Okay, you're good. Now, while we're kind of setting that piece up, let me kind of describe what the soil moisture sensor does. It actually is sending some electricity, and if you guys remember the whole idea of a circuit is that it has to complete a circle. A circuit is very much like a big loop, and it's sending electricity along a path, and as long as it comes back to the original spot, then it's going to complete a circuit, right? So this actually is doing that, and this is the break in the circuit right here. these two little forks. Well, the moisture in the ground is conductive, so what we can do is send a little electricity signal through the ground, or you know, through one side of the probe. The moisture in the ground or the dirt will be conductive enough to actually transmit the signal to the other side. Well, depending on the amount of conductivity in the soil, that's how we can get a percentage of soil moisture. And this is really kind of nice for anyone that does any kind of gardening. So I know that in Alicante, you guys have a small garden in front of like third grade area, but maybe this is something that, you know, some of the, if there's a school garden in your school, you can actually use this equipment and monitor the soil, like for the watering. So like after every watering cycle, you can have kids go in there and put it in the ground and just log it for a week or two, just see if they're getting enough, you know, moisture. Now, the thing is, it's kind of a subjective piece because moisture in the ground varies from 0 to 45%. At zero, that means it's dry desert land, right? That's like, you know, most of the farm fields before this big rain season happened. And then 45% would look like much of Lamont right now does, right? So it's the point where it's completely saturated and there's no more air in the ground that can hold water. So it rises above the ground and it's just floating everywhere, right? I was really kind of blown away when I was driving in that field. And then the river is like the little canal next to it is just flowing still. Like, where is it going to go? So I guess that's everyone's question, right? So impressed. So anyways, what we'll do with this is we're going to actually have to load the code onto the Arduino board or the red board. So let's go ahead and just kind of go back to this website, and I'll kind of show you from here where, you know, how we'll do this. You know, so if you haven't already followed through these steps, you've loaded it. Now what we need to do is just make sure that we have Arduino set up. So I'm going to just minimize this for a second. If you have an Arduino icon, I know I'm using a Mac and it might look different, but if you minimize all of your Windows desktop, there's an Arduino icon. You double click that Arduino icon and just to make sure it's active. Now, I'll load mine really quickly just to show you.
Okay.
Right. Just want to make sure you know where it's at. I know most of you guys already activated it, but I'm going to back you up for a second, and this is where I need to make sure that you're listening to what I'm saying. All right. I love it. So in order for us to actually get this to work, what we have to do is make sure that the program is closed, plug in our power cord, and then we reinitialize the program. Because if we initialize the program now as it is, it won't recognize when I plug it in. So it's not a big deal. What I was trying to do was show you guys where the icon was. So if you close the program down, exit out, close it down, grab your power cord, plug it in, and I'll walk around really quickly to make sure that everyone knows where to mount the cord. If you're new to this, you'll see that there's this little tiny micro USB side. You'll just mount it on there, and I'll show you as well. Do you see where I'm mounting it? Right here? Okay. This group over here knows where I'm mounting. Perfect. All right. Do you see where I'm plugging it? Yeah, perfect. All right, and you guys have it on the side? Okay, so that part is there. All right, so now, all I'm going to do is plug it into my computer at this point. I need to close down my computer or my Arduino program. The software should not be running before I plug it in. All right. Give it a second to recognize the USB port. All right. So now it's active, it's on there, but I have to make sure that it actually recognizes my computer or that it's recognizing the Arduino board. So there is a few things. Let me just maximize it so you see it. Once you have the window open, if you're looking in the front, there's this button or this menu called Tools. And what I have to do is two things. I have to make sure that I have selected an Arduino Uno. That's this type of board. That's the real version. We're using a generic version of an Arduino Uno, but that's the software it's recognizing. So I'm going to go to the board first, select Arduino Uno. It's probably already selected. Just make sure it is. And you click it, it'll put a little check mark next to it. It'll be active Arduino Uno. Okay? And for those of you guys, my table representatives, those of you guys that are already at that point, you can just look over here really quickly and just help your neighbors. There's going to be several different of these ports. If you have a Mac, it'll actually recognize it as a USB something or another. So you'll see a bunch of gibberish, and then it'll say somewhere in there USB, USB serial maybe. But if you're using an HP, one of these, it's COM 11, or it's usually the last COM port. That's what Joel was telling us yesterday. Okay. Okay. So let me try and give one more additional piece of information. So if you're using an HP, let me just get everyone to look up here in front. If I can see your eyes in front. Eyes in front, please. So here's what I know about computers in general. They actively search those USB ports the whole time. And to less complicate things, what I would recommend doing is pulling any USB, the mouse cords out of it. If you have like a dongle or anything plugged into the USB ports, unplug those first. Just put in the SparkFun or the Arduino USB and then reinitialize, so that way it only has to search for one. You can plug those USB ports in at any time, but just unplug all those other ones for now. Plug in just the breadboard, reinitialize the Arduino icon, and that may help your troubles. Hey, so it seems to me like some of us are ready to go and some of us still have a concern. Let me just kind of give some next steps, and while we're helping the other people, you guys can kind of at least begin with the next step. So if you just look up in the front really quickly, I'll show you kind of how I've set up this presentation. And at times it might seem like some of the slides are really information packed. And it's mostly just because if you decide to try these later on, you won't have to go back and research anything. It'll just be right there on the screen. So what you should notice is there's this little matrix icon, right? The scrolling icon. Those are all hyperlinked to code. So anytime that you see this, it's because I've provided you with a computer program that you can use for your Arduino. And in Google Slides, all you do is click that, and it will open up the hyperlink, so you can actually activate some code. This particular code is for the soil moisture sensor, and all you're going to do is highlight this entire set of code and right-click, copy, paste. So we're going to right-click, copy that. So I'm going to take all this code, and I'm going to paste it into Arduino once my Arduino is active. So anyone in here that actually has an active Arduino, you can go into the Arduino. And what you have to do here is just erase all that. Just highlight, get rid of it, backspace, and then copy paste all of that new serial code into here. And so now you'll see we don't have to learn how to program yet. That's baby. We're going to do baby steps on this programming piece. I'm not going to try and teach you guys how to program. But what I will help you do is interpret some of the code and teach you how to modify codes that's been given, and that's kind of what I'll try to do today. That'll be our goal. So anyone that's able to get an active reading on their computer, like if you're in tools and you notice that your port is hooked into the USB or COM11, whatever it might be on your HP, then you can copy paste this, and the upload is the next piece. You just go and upload. Oh, I have to save this. I'm going to name it soil moisture. I took the code from a Vernier and I adapted it to work for the, so I modified it myself. Yeah. Yep. So you'll want all of the entire page. So I'm just going to save this to desktop, by the way, and I'm just looking for table representatives to follow this step. I'm going to give next steps to some of you guys that are there. I know some of you guys aren't with us yet, but let me go back over some things. All right. Here's where I'll back up some. Here's where I started. I went and made sure that I had my Arduino set up. I know that my computer is being read into the right port. So I've had that checked. That's the most important thing, or else you're not going to have any kind of communication. Now, once I have that done, I need to make sure that I go back to my presentation, and all of the code that I'm going to use, this will not work. It will not read information from the, well, it might read it, it's not going to make any sense to you. So we actually have to give it instructions to analyze that data that's coming through, because right now it's just electric signals, and it's just interpreting numbers between 0 and 1023. So we need to actually say that numbers have meaning to us. And so what I'll do is I go down to slide number 4. I'm going to open up this window, and you'll know you're at the right one because it says Vernier. You'll see it at the top, Vernier soil moisture sensor. And all I'm going to do is just highlight the very top. Now, if you're on that screen already, you'll notice that as I'm highlighting, it's highlighting on your page, but that's not the same as you highlighting, right? So you need to make sure that you highlight the whole entire code, which is 2 pages, right click, copy, and then you need to go into your Arduino. And if you want to start, you can start a new file, and it just blank. You can get rid of all that code that's on there, just highlight, backspace, clear it all off. And then just right-click, paste, or Control-V if you're using keyboard. It's there now. It's got all the instruction that I need to use. And what I want to do is upload, if you're looking at the screen, a table representative, someone from each table, just make sure that you're looking at the computer on the screen. And just if you hover over these, they'll tell you what they do. I want to upload, so I'm going to click upload. And if you have to save it, of course, so I'm going to name it the soil moisture. And this one I have to write sensor because I wrote the last one, soil moisture. I'm going to save it to desktop. That makes the most sense for you guys using these HPs as well because it's going to disappear into these hidden folders. So just save it to desktop. Hit save. And you'll notice down here at the bottom, you'll see it actually processing. It's sending all of this code, all of these instructions to the computer or to the microprocessor here. And at some point, it'll say, done uploading. And it might say, thank you. On mine, because I'm using a Mac, it has this special program that recognizes for Macs. And now it's there. Go ahead. No, please.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so it's automatically just saving to default is what it's doing then, which is fine. Yeah.
Did you have to open a different one, or you could have done that?
Yeah, I could have used the first. So whatever one I upload is the you can have 10 programs open at once, and you can upload each one. It will only handle one program at a time. So you cannot upload this, upload the next one, and it won't store it. There's a very limited space. And so the computer just says, whatever you upload, everything else gets cleared off. This one program is running, okay? So I uploaded a program already, and I want to share this with you guys because this is kind of important. When you do this, let me maximize the screen. This program has been uploaded. It shows that it's been uploaded. So it currently is actively processing. It's doing exactly what I'm telling it to do. It's reading from this sensor. It's telling it what to do. It's interpreting this data and telling me what percentage of moisture is being, or is in this, well, in this case, the air, right? Which is like a negative reading. It doesn't understand when there's no conductivity between the two. But how do I look at that data? Where do I find that data? That's an important point because a lot of you guys are going to be, you know, doing work with this, and then you're like, okay, I just ran that program. What's happening? What am I supposed to do now? So there is a way on this computer, on the Arduino, to analyze the, or at least read the data that it's being, that's coming from this. And that's called the serial port. Do you see all these, this line of code that's called serial? It says serial begin, serial print, and then all of this stuff. That is code to say, print all this information that you're gathering from these variables and put them onto the serial monitor. So here's the serial monitor. If you look up in the corner, table representatives especially, do you see I'm in the top right corner, serial monitor? Click on that, and this window pops up, and now it's showing you readings of this water moisture sensor or soil moisture sensor. So here's the data that we were looking for. Every second. Yeah, you notice that it's happening every second. Now, watch what happens when I put my hand around it. Watch what happens when I put my hand around it. Do you see what happened to the readings? Oops, let me move this over some. See how they've actually changed? Well, this isn't set up to use, it's not a hand sensitivity or, you know, it doesn't check how clammy you are. It's meant for dirt and soil, so it's been calibrated to work with dirt. So if you don't have dirt with you here, I have a thing over here, you're welcome to try it, and I want to kind of demonstrate to make sure you have used it, but when it's just in the open air, it gives you these false readings of negative some percentage, and that really doesn't mean anything to us, but it does work, and I want to just demonstrate how you use this in your regular classroom, if and when you get a chance to use it. So I grabbed some soil from the ground, and it's moist, it's not wet, but my first intuition tells me just to kind of plug it into the dirt, right, like this, but the way that these read is it's actually going to read it's sending signals across the forks. So if you put this into the ground, as you go deeper in the ground, moisture in the soil changes, right? So it's going to give you false readings if you just put these forks straight into the ground. What we have to do is put it horizontal to the ground, so that way it gives you a good reading. Now, if you want it to measure like root, like where the roots are at, then you need to make sure you dig it deep enough into the ground and kind of put it as horizontal as you can, right? And then once you see that, it'll show you an accurate reading. So right now, this is reading at about 5.5-6% moisture. And maybe that's what I want it to be, because I'm looking at the soil, and in my mind, I've done enough gardening to know that this is pretty good soil moisture right here where it's at. I don't want to overwater this. The closer I get to 45%, the more watering I'm going to get to. So this is something that you can actually do, and I will put this down for a second and show you guys that this is set up to actually run off of a laptop, which is nice, but it's not really that convenient if you want to do something like monitor soil for 24 hours. Mm-hmm. Not a really good setup, but it actually has a battery pack that you can actually plug into this, and it'll run on 9 volts. You can put it into a case, an airtight case or something, set it off to the side, and it will monitor this for, you know, as long as the battery is gone, and, you know, you can use it that way as well. So it has the capability of doing, like, actual work for later on time. Now, there's Wi-Fi shields, an extra shield that you can put on top of this that you can actually connect it to the internet, and then you can do things like operate from Twitter. You can actually have it send you a Twitter feed saying an update every so often saying your moisture is at 35% or it's at 10%, whatever. There's a lot of cloud-based programs that are now kicking in, that are starting, and they do a lot of this stuff. So it's kind of a neat little extension to this. I see it right now, it's blinking at 1 second every time that it's going through, it's kind of cycling at 1 second. It's taking a reading every 1 second. Can I change this to where it maybe will cycle every 5 seconds?
Yes.
Can you guys do that for me and look onto your code and just try to identify where the time is being, if we change one variable value, it should be able to change this. And I want to see you guys do that. And change it to anything. I think 5 is good. You don't want to make it a minute. It'll take you forever to figure out if it's working. Anybody have any ideas of where it might be? Let me hear some from you guys. Feedback from you guys.
Plus 5 instead of plus 1.
Okay, where are you talking about? Okay, so the very end, you're saying on this very bottom where I'm in the void loop section right here. I can't, so which part are you saying?
It's the time between readings and then
start so at
0.
It does say delay. And that to me tells me that it's going to pause the computer program for doing something. So delay is exactly what you think it is. So you're right on that. But then there it's saying delay this variable name. So it's a function. It's saying delay whatever numbers inside that function. Well, that function in particular is a variable name, time between readings. So I can't change that word. But is there a variable somewhere named time between readings that's been identified or defined?
On the top.
On the very top, right? So okay, I'm at the very top. Do you see right here where it says int, which stands for integer? So we're talking about numbers that are like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, positive, negative. So it's saying create a variable that's called an integer, and then it's saying 1,000. Well, over to the side, do you see those little forward slashes? These are super important to programmers, and the better that you get at this, the more you're going to want to see forward slashes, because what that does, those are what we call documentation. It helps us recognize what this code means. And it's like trying to put together a 1,000-piece, model or something without any kind of instructions. It's really difficult without documentation. So anytime that you see forward slashes, take a second and read it. And with your students, when you do programming, always encourage them to explain what the code means. That's a great way to get them writing and justifying as well. But explain what that means. Well, that says MS.
Milliseconds.
Milliseconds, right. So a 1,000th of a second. So if I said 1, I'm going to try this. This might be interesting to see. I'm going to try 1, just change the time between readings 1, and I'm going to upload it. It's processing. Okay, what happened? Why am I not seeing the answers? I need to see some values here. What do I have to do? Okay, so I have it. It's finished running. It's uploaded, but I don't see any data. Top right, serial monitor, right? So we're going to have to open the serial monitor. After I've uploaded it, I'm going to go to serial monitor. And give it a second. Whoa! Processing as fast as it can at 1 millisecond, which is 1/1,000th of a second. Now, it's definitely not going that fast, but it's pretty fast. It's trying to keep up with it, and if the computer could process it faster, that's way too fast. So 1 is not the answer I want. What if I changed it to 5 then? Is that going to be the answer I need? What if I just change this to 5?
No, it's still going to be fast.
We did 5,000.
Oh, 5,000, no, because we're talking about milliseconds, right? So I need 5,000 to cancel out the milli. So 5,000 is the same as 5 seconds. Upload. It's uploading. Making sure it works. It's done processing. Okay, it's active. Nothing's happening, though. Serial port, right? So we're going to have to go and make sure we go into a serial monitor. And let's just, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It should print something next. And then the next 5 seconds, it prints something. Yes, ma'am, go ahead.
Okay, I keep getting an error when I try to upload.
Okay, so here's what I'm thinking happened, and I will kind of mention this to you because it has application to everyone. Sometimes when you are, I'll close this up real quick. This works, we see that it works here. But she had a great question that we could all address. I helped another person a minute ago, and when she was highlighting, she went like this and highlighted. Do you see what happened?
Yeah.
Okay, what happened here? Help us out. Yeah, is that very top line means something? It says ignore these sentences. They're not program code lines. So if you did not highlight that piece, then it's going to try and interpret what this is, and it's not going to mean anything to the computer. So go back and highlight from the very beginning, and then all the way down to the second page. If you stop short, I know it's hard to see, but if you stop short, that close bracket, make sure you get that as well. That would be my initial response to what maybe happened on your computer. That's a guess. I'll come back and check after you load it up. But there it is. Now, this is a good introduction. I used this idea. We kind of worked on this last time when we were together, but it's a great introduction to kind of revisit how to load code and how to check data, because that serial monitor off to the side is really important. It's useful to us. What I would like to see is us get to a point where we have, you know, you guys are working on these problems, you guys can upload programs yourself, you can make little changes, and don't be afraid. If you mess up something over here, like if you erase the time between readings and put something else there, and it causes all kinds of stuff to happen, then just erase the program, re-upload the new version. It's all safe online. So you can play with this. And this is what I'm hoping to do. I promise you guys, Bill Gates, back when he was in fifth grade, when he was working at a college, he was given time to go work on a computer at college. I promise you, he didn't sit down and read a programming book. I promise you, he didn't sit there and go page one, okay, and that makes sense. He didn't take any courses. What he did was he walked in and saw someone else's programming code, and then he started changing numbers, and he goes, hey, that's pretty interesting. Now I get this. And do you see what I'm saying? So the way that you learn programming, at least at the initial phase, is to get over the fear of messing stuff up and just start looking at what these things mean and start kind of getting meaning to it. It's like learning how to read for the first time. And once you get into that point, you slowly start to say, hey, this is kind of neat. I can make my own programs, and that's what I want to do. So let's go ahead and just kind of, we can minimize this. You don't have to close the whole thing down. But I'm going to go back into my presentation really quickly. I will mention to you guys that there's also a code for a temperature probe. Now, when I wrote this code, it was for the same type of temperature probe that you don't have. I didn't know that. He told me you guys bought temperature probes, but I assumed you guys got this one. You actually have the USB version. And the USB version is really nice because you can plug it in and you can just go to a Chromebook. You can plug it into a Chromebook and you can go and use Vernier's graphical analysis program. So let me show you something really quickly. At the very bottom down here in the little presenter notes, I wrote down the name of the Chrome extension. And if you go and load that Chrome extension on your own time, and if you have that USB cable, you don't have to do any of this stuff. It puts it on a nice graph for you and everything. So you can use a temperature probe the same way. But these are a lot cheaper than the USB version. So if you want to buy a classroom set, then this, along with your breadboard, you can get them for $15 a piece, and the code is there as well. So I'm just going to provide you with that code, and we're going to move on. All right. I want to have a quick conversation with you guys about this idea, but let me load this up, and we good? Okay. So what I want to do is kind of introduce this idea of Arduino's microprocessor. That's what this is, a breadboard Arduino microprocessor. And what I want to do is kind of present this opportunity to you guys to kind of just be at the first. There isn't any school districts that I can think of that have a curriculum-wide, across the board using Arduinos or any type of microprocessors to help teach instruction or teach technology, teach math or science. So I applaud, your efforts today and your patience. I'm hoping we can kind of go through a couple of these things. But what I want you to recognize is that you guys are definitely on the front lines. And if we can get you guys on board, and if I can get you guys to where you guys are saying, yes, this is something that we can do and we can bring into our school, then that's the first step to bringing it to the masses. We won't be able to convince the teacher that has nothing to do with SKMP or any other type of tech ed programs or STEM programs. We're not going to be able to convince them unless we have a lead group of people that are already trying these things on their own. So I applaud your efforts and your patience for being here. The way that I'm going to introduce this to my residents tomorrow, we're going to start this out, is we actually have problems that I give them, and I'm going to present them with a problem, which is very much what I'll talk with you guys about today, is, well, how can we monitor an environment? That's what I'm going to mention to them at the very beginning of the class, and learn how to use different types of sensors to create environmental sensors or monitoring systems that we use in all different types of environments. So what kinds of things do we monitor with sensors already? Think about this. This is a question I want you guys to talk to everybody about. So take a second with your closest groups. Can you think of any types of sensors we use? There's soil moisture sensors, there's temperature sensors. How are they used in the real world, like practical application? Take a couple minutes and do that for me real quick. There's no right answer to this. There's sensors being used throughout. I mean, in this room alone, can you name any sensor that we might find?
Air conditioner.
Air conditioner. What kind of sensor do they use for monitoring the air conditioner use? A thermostat, which is temperature based, right? So they have some type of thing that says, if it gets too cold, too hot in here, turn on an air conditioner in one way or the other, right? So hot or cold. Say that again? Yeah, so there's probably sensors built into, well, I don't see sprinklers here. That's kind of concerns me. No, just kidding. No, but in a typical room, there are those sensors, and if they melt, then they kick on a water line, right? And so that's another type of system that they have in place. What about lights? Have you ever been in a room that just turns on the lights when you walk in? That's a motion sensor usually, or a light, some type of light sensor. There's a lot of different uses for these, and so the problem that I'm going to present to my students tomorrow, it has a lot to do with this, so it's kind of nice that we kind of played hand in hand. But here's different types of sensors. So you could use a sensor to monitor light, to temperature. An interesting one that you may not have thought of is an altitude sensor. If you're in an airplane, it's kind of important to make sure you're above the mountains, right? Or, different reasons for that. Like weather balloons, they also do this type of thing. Moisture, we were talking in the back about the gardening. Some people that have rain sensors, so like if it rains, it turns off all your sprinklers. So that's a water sensor that knows or detects water, you know, filling into a little container somewhere. So there's all these different sensors that are important to know, and they help us. And some of the things that you might see them being used in would be things like animal enclosures, like an aquarium. You could actually use a water sensor or a temperature probe on your Arduino board, your red board, in your own classroom with a fish tank, and to monitor the temperature of the water to make sure it's not too cold or too hot, maybe the location of it. They make different things for those, like mentioned gardening, and of course comfort, right? Air conditioning. I'm hoping today that we can actually investigate a little further an air conditioning sensor. I want to build an air conditioner, and the easiest version of an air conditioner, and it's something that's like says if it gets too hot, then turn a fan on, right? I think we can build one of those. At least we can draw the schematics for it today and get that finished. So that's the plan. So yeah. I brought this to your attention earlier. How would I bring this, or how would I introduce this type of instrument to my class? Let's say I'm in a fourth grade class. How would I introduce this instrument to my fourth grade class? I will be honest with you, I wouldn't just give a box to every kid and just say, go have fun, look at the book, and try it out. I wouldn't do that with them. I think that there's too much that's here that needs to be studied and learned before they can get there. And I think that there's people with a like mind, because they created these sites like circuits.io that help us kind of, you know, like scaffold this whole process to students. So what I want to do is this. I'm going to definitely have to unplug my Arduino. So before we transition to that, what I want to do is just unplug it, the power first. I'm going to unplug the power first, remove the cord. Oh, you can keep your cord plugged in, but I need to kind of clean up my space. Your sensor, make sure you pull that tab, or you push the tab to press it, and then pull it out before you do that. It'll break. And then you will need to pull this apart, so you'll have to take the shield off. Now, when you do that, try not to just pull it on one side. So lift a little on one side, go back and forth, like kind of rock it back and forth. So that way you're applying, you're pulling it from all different sides. And now, I will say storage of this is kind of important. It came in a bubble-wrapped paper. Static would be a bad thing for this, so putting it back into that plastic wrap and then putting it away. I'll give you a moment to do that, but we'll want to get everything off of our Arduino board. The nice thing about this whole circuits.io, this website, is it's a cloud-based software. So you'll need internet for it, obviously. But the nice thing is that you may only be able to buy 20 of these SparkFun kits at $100 a piece. You may only be able to get 20 of them and share with a grade level. If that, then that's being generous, right? I get that. But to do something in the same exact, to work with these on a one-to-one basis, giving the kids a Chromebook, which you all have a cart probably in your room, or you have access to a cart, the circuits.io is a free software that's online, and every student can work with an Arduino board for free. So you can have every student doing this, and the work that you start in school can then translate to home if they decide to do something on their own at home. Now, the way I envision this happening in summer school is I'm going to train students. The older grades, I'm going to start with my fifth and sixth grade groups. I'm going to train them on circuits.io, and they will not get a SparkFun kit until they've proven competency on what we're doing with the circuits.io. So we'll make that like the finish line. They actually get to build on the Arduino after they've shown me that they can build it here. So it's a really nice thing, and you can use Chromebooks for them. So at this point, what I would recommend is if you didn't plug in your mouse back, I would plug the mouse back in so you can have that. And make sure you're logged in. Yeah, it's easier. Yeah, it's easier to work. You can do it with a touchpad, but you won't like it. I won't. I didn't, I should say. So circuits.io is a great program because it's free. It's Chromebook capable, so you can use this on Chromebooks. So you can have 30 kids using it in the classroom, and they could all be doing their own projects, or they can all be following along with you like I'm going to show you today. And all of the stuff that's on there is digital. So the idea is we will build virtual schematics, virtual wiring, virtual Arduino boards. We'll use all of that in the virtual sense. Once we have accomplished that on a computer, then I will translate all of that to the actual piece. Now, there's some other great things about this, and the biggest thing that I think is it's worth mentioning is that typically when kids plug LEDs into the breadboard and they just put wires in there saying, okay, let's put some power into it, turn it on, it will blow up the LEDs. There's too much power going through to it. So that's something that they have to worry about. Now, when I say blow up, I don't mean mushroom clouds in the classroom, everyone leaves coughing. It's not one of those scenarios. It's just it's on and then it turns off and they don't know what happens. So they pull the light out, plug a new one in, it's on, and then they'll do that three or four times. That can get pricey if you try to do that with 30 kids. So when we start off with circuits.io, when we start off in the virtual world, it will actually tell you, hey, there's too much power on this circuit, fix that. So it's nice because you can actually just plug in things and try out your initial ideas, and it will tell you, hey, there's something wrong with the way that you're doing it. So if you plug something into any hole on this black rail, it will work. And the same is true with these numbers, the horizontals. These are also rails. It'll make a lot of sense if I actually can show you on the thing, because it highlights and it'll show you. So you do not have to plug it into F21 exactly.
Because
so,
that's what it had us do the first time.
Right. In the diagram, it shows you to plug it into a rail, and as long as you're on the rail, you'll be fine. And I think that there's an initial fear, like, I don't want to burn something out. I don't want to mess this up. But doing it in the virtual world first, it's okay, because it'll let you know, hey, you're going about it all wrong or whatever. So let me kind of show you guys how we started. Now, if you just came back, what we did was we went into circuits.io, and we went and clicked on new electronics lab. So we need to create a new electronics lab. And if you just look at the screen real quick, I'll leave this up. The first thing that you'll see when you create your new lab is a breadboard. Well, we can actually select different breadboards just by clicking it with your mouse and backspace, it will delete. So clicking, delete, and then you can add new components. So that's what I want to show you guys. I'm going to set up your circuits.io. So if you're on circuits.io, I'll go through this first step with you. I'm just going to now, you were talking about rails, remember that? Look how I hover over this. Do you see how everything highlights in green? That's saying that this entire horizontal rail is connected. That's one circuit. So if I plug a power line into that, if I add power to that rail somewhere, as long as I plug power or another wire into there, it's going to give me power. So it's a rail. And the same is true with this. Do you see how it highlights right here? Mm-hmm. Do you notice how it stops right here in the gap and then this is different? Because these are two different sets of rails. So as long as you plug it into this rail, somewhere on this rail, then you're going to have that continuation of your circuit. Okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to click on the outside of, not on the dots themselves, but I'm going to click somewhere in between this blank space. Do you see how the blue highlighting around it? It's saying you've selected a breadboard. Well, I want to get rid of this breadboard because it looks nothing like this one. So I want to get rid of it, and I'm going to go to new components. So my table leaders, if you're watching, new components. Okay? So let me go back then. It's all right. So what I did was I selected the breadboard just by clicking on the white space somewhere. So it puts a blue lining on it, backspace, and it just deletes it. Yeah, no problem. And I think the trash can also, if you select and then you hit the trash can, it will delete it as well. But I just hit backspace on my keyboard. All right, table leaders, especially components, clicking on components. Now you'll notice this little pop-up window on the bottom, select, deselect. It just, if you want it, and hey, maybe you want to look at it a little bit more so you can drag the window open and then deselect it, it disappears, selects, right? Now I want to include a breadboard. Well, breadboard is spelled just like you would think, breadboard. And you'll notice that they give me three different options. Which one looks the most like our breadboard? The breadboard small. So if I click it, I think you actually, yeah. So if you click it and maybe drag, click, drag with holding it down, it will put it onto your screen, and let me minimize this window so you can see I have it already. Yeah, and I'm just going to move it around because sometimes we get trigger happy and we add four breadboards. So, okay, if you did, select, delete, or select trash. All right, so there's breadboard. Okay, so you're on circuits.io already? Okay, and you've signed in. And did you add a new? Okay, so you sign in, and then you add a new electronics lab. So sign in and take care of that, and I'll come and talk with you privately. Yeah. So we'll want to make sure we do a search for an Arduino. So I'm going to add a new component, right? So go to your plus component. That window pops open, and I have it. We can actually just name it Arduino. SparkFun is a generic version of Arduino, right? So there is a SparkFun on there? Oh, they add components all the time. That's nice that they have the SparkFun. So I'm going to just type in Arduino. And do you see that it says Arduino Uno? That's the one that we're using. If you remember when I went to the program, I had to select Arduino Uno, Genuino Uno. So this is the one I'm going to use. I'm going to click and drag it. It's there now. So let me close this components window so I can show you. Yeah, it's going to look like yours. You'll notice that it has the analog and digital keys, or the pins opening, analog, digital, but it's blue because that's the genuine Arduino version of it. That's the original Italian version board. Now, let me go ahead and say a couple of things to you guys. With a mouse, if you wheel up and wheel down, you're going to zoom in and out on the screen, which is nice. So if you want to zoom out so you can kind of manipulate the two, or zoom in so you can see which hole it's going into, that's why the mouse is really important to use today. Give you a second to do that. Hey, do me a favor. If you click on the breadboard anywhere, you'll notice that it's going to start creating this like green line. If you look on the screen, that's a wire. Every time you click the button down, it'll put a bend in the wire. Put a bend in the wire. Play with that for a second. Just learn how to use it. And then just plug it into some other hole. Do you see how I did that? It'll be nice later on because you'll want to manipulate the wires, maybe move them out of your way. So you go and grab one of the dots, and it'll move it so you can actually manipulate the wire. See what I'm doing here? All right, I'll do it again one more time. I'm just moving it around, clicking buttons. Another important thing, table reps, my table reps especially, if you look up here, an important idea is to color my cables. It'll be nice when I can change them into red and black. So my table reps, if you can focus on this piece for me, you can share that with your groups. So practice that for a second. I'm going to go and just check with everybody. This is kind of where the two groups, there's going to be people that are really confident and really feeling good about this. They're going to kind of excel, and then everyone else will be like, why are you going so fast? Let me start off by just providing you with some information. I know Tony did this with you guys last time, and I kind of introduced this book with you guys prior in summer. I'm going to say that this is going to be a good resource for you guys today, so if you have it with you, take it out. And then if I mention something like temp 36 sensor, just going to the front table of contents, you'll see that there's a temperature sensor, like there's a couple of pages that show you how to wire a temperature sensor, describe the sensor's schematics and everything. So I'm going to recommend that you open it up. In fact, why don't we do this together? Help me out. I want to know what page can I look in this book to find out more information about a temperature sensor. It's in the black box. Yeah, yeah. On the, oh, okay. Page 45. So if I go to page 45, I'm hoping to find something about a temperature sensor in here, because I'm going to need to identify what a temperature sensor looks like in a few. On page 45, they even show me how to wire it, but on page 46, they give me a more detailed schematic of the wiring. So in my book that's inside of the, it's on the bottom of your black box. Yeah, on your SIK, it's on the bottom side. And it's there, and you can have that book. Or 46 is probably a better example of it. But there's a little sensor on there, and it's, the actual name of the sensor is TMP Temp 36. So it's a Temp 36 sensor. And what it is an environmental sensor. It actually will detect the temperature of the room that you're in. Well, yes, you have one inside of your kit, but we're not working with the physical kit. Nobody's digging for it in the box. Let's go and find out where it's on here, because it's nice. They provide all these different things that cost money for free in the virtual world here. So how am I going to add a temp sensor to this? Remind me the steps. What do I need to do to find a temp sensor? Add components, right? I need to start by adding components right here. Okay, now walk me through that. Okay, so I can just look through the list, but that will take a long time. There's a search bar right here that actually will be nice. I'm going to type in TMP 36, and it pops up on the screen. It just searched through all of the different parts. Do you see that little temp 36 sensor? With your mouse, click and hold and just drag it over and drop it anywhere. And I'm going to minimize my components so that way you can see it on my screen. So table representatives especially, if you grab this temp 36 sensor wherever it's at, it will align onto the breadboard anywhere. And that's all I want to do is just stick it into the breadboard somewhere. Any holes, it doesn't matter. It doesn't, in the book it may say into F26 or whatever, but just put it into the breadboard somewhere. All right, what I need to do though is open up that page 46 and look and see how they wire this thing. That's an important point.
Does it matter which way the breadboard's going?
Nope, no, so I can actually flip this breadboard. Oops, let me. Okay. Yeah, so I can flip it around by doing this rotate if you want to flip it different directions. The wiring is still the same. However I orient this thing, it won't matter. Okay? And if you decide to put your temp sensor on this side instead, that's fine as long as you wire this side of the board instead of that side. Okay? So let me just make a flip on the, oops, select the breadboard. Give me 1 second and I'm going to reorient this. All right, I'm going to plug.
Orient that to go horizontal.
Okay, let me fix my breadboard the same way you have yours. So tell me when it, is it like this?
Yes.
Okay, and then your temp sensor will then have to just be, so you'll just have to orient your temp sensor then.
Okay,
yeah.
So it doesn't matter.
Oh, I see what you're saying now. Yeah, you can have it plug in like this if you want. In fact, you have to do it this way. I would say, I would recommend orienting your breadboard to where it's horizontal with ours. This is probably the most, I guess the easiest way to kind of think of it. We're all on the same page. Yeah, friendly, thank you. I noticed that on page 46, there's some power cords. So I need some power cords. So go ahead and try and label your power cords. There's 5 wires that we need to install onto this, right? So I'm using my book to help me do this. And it's also on the presentation, but I would say focus on the book. So power, it shows that I'm going from 5 volts to the rail on the side, the power rail. So watch what I'm going to do. If you just go around, click a button, click, click, and then I'm going to drop it into the positive. 5 volts, yeah, we're making this 5 volts. And then I need to also provide a circuit by doing ground. So the next step is to make a ground. Okay, so now, how do I change the color? Someone asked a minute ago, how do I change the color? I'm gonna click on a wire and then the menu pops up. Positive red, negative black. Then I noticed that there is 3 wires that are gonna jump over to the temp sensor, right? And in the picture, they have it going into 5, 6, and 7. But I really just need to make sure that I hook it into these 3 plugs. Now, it's hard for me to understand. Oh, I see this right here. It says GND. What does that stand for? Ground. So what I'll do is I'm just going to go up to this rail, which is the ground rail. It doesn't matter which one I plug. Just grab one of the ground rails and click it so it draws the line. And I'm going to make sure that I hook it into any of the rails that light up here on this. Do you see how these all line up green? So as long as I put it here, it's grounded. What color should I make that wire? Black. All right. Now, do you know which one is the hot or the positive wire on this temperature sensor? See how there's 3? Is it VS or is it V out? That's an important question. So I'm going to go back to page 45. It actually shows you the wiring schematic on that. So it'll say, hey, if you're looking at it this direction, there's ground on one side and then there's V positive, which is the positive. So I'll make sure that I put the positive onto this rail over here. Hey, so the last one that I have to plug in is that middle leg. Those little pins are called legs. So the middle leg, which is what they call V out, and that's your data cable. So this is actually the setup that shows the temperature. So it's going to take the readings. It needs the power for the readings, but it's actually going to take this data and send it to your computer. So where am I going to make this? I know I'm going to connect a V out on this rail somewhere. But where on the Arduino should I plug it into? That's a page 46 question. I'm sorry? So this is my V out, but where is it going to plug into on the Arduino? Let me look on the, oh yeah. A0? A0, yes, it's an analog. So this is an analog sensor, so I'm going to go and plug it into A, And I'm just going to go down, click so it bends, click so it bends again, plug it in. I'm one of these kind of people that if I notice that the line is kind of crooked, I will actually try to straighten it, and it does a nice job for you. It'll light up in blue to show you that yes, it's vertically straight and horizontally straight. So if you need 90 degree angles, or if you're that person, then there you go. It's there for you, right? Like this bugs me up here on the top already, right? So I'm gonna fix that. I'm good. So while we're waiting for others, that's how you make them nice and clean. Or the bottom. Now, as long as you have power coming into the board, you see how this power is coming in? I'm sending the power to these two legs, and then that data is going out to A0, five cables. All right, now, here's also another one of my quirks, is that if I'm using just a sensor that has a power, a ground, and a data, I like to color that data cable blue. Most times, if I can, it's just a way, it's like the same way you recognize red as being the power or the hot. I like to try and make that a blue for data. So I'm going to make this blue color. And that just says, hey, that's a data cable. That's my own little thing. And I don't know if it's industry standard or not, but when I try to use data cables, I try to make them blue. All right. I think we have everything here. The only thing I have to do now is tell the computer how to recognize this temperature sensor to get the readings and to interpret them, like programming, right? So we need to worry about the code. Well, I'm going to go back to my presentation. I know some of you are still trying to make your wires nice and pretty. But table reps, if you look up here on the screen, I've gone through these steps already on how to add a sensor. This is the Temp36 to collect data. I'm now on slide 13 on my presentation. Do you see the matrix scrolling icon? If I click it, it will link me to the Temp36 code. So do you see where it says sketch 1? Temp36 sketch 1, this is the code that I'm going to upload. So I've created this temp, well, I modified, I can't take credit for this. I found some code online that was from somewhere, probably SIK, and then I just changed it to match what I want it to show. So I've modified this code myself. So highlight all of it, right click, copy. Make sure you copy it.
What slide was it?
Okay, so it's on slide, remind us group, what slide were we on the presentation? 13. Yes, slide 13 is where you're going to be at.
Did you click on it?
So you clicked on slide 13. Watch on the screen. Yeah, you click the screen, always on the little graphic, and then that'll open up the link. Now, if you remember last time, I took the code and I went and opened Arduino. We're not working with physical Arduino today. We're working with virtual Arduino, which means I'm not going to plug in my Arduino board in. We're not going to try and get connections again. We are working towards that goal, but right now we are just focused on going back to the Circuits.io, let me make sure I'm on the right one. I'm on Circuits.io. If you notice, there's this button up here, my table reps. If you notice, there's a code editor. Click that, and then you'll see, hey, there's all this code down here. I need to get rid of this code, because I don't want this program to work. I want the program I just copy-pasted to work. So I'm going to just right-click copy and paste. All right, so I'll stop right there. You can upload it as well, but I'm going
to
walk around and help people in particular.
Okay.
Most of you guys are at the point where you have copy-pasted the code into the code editor, and some of you recognize that there is a upload or code, upload and run, which is kind of like saying the button on the Arduino the same way. You'll notice there's two things here. There's an upload and run, which you can use, but then there's also this start simulator or start simulation, right? So if you do this, this is kind of like a virtual process of running your program. You download it or upload it to your Arduino board. And it's look, it says stop, which means it's going to stop if I click that button. So it stops. And if you, let me zoom out real quick. See this power cord unplugged? When I hit the simulator, it plugs it in. So it's saying, hey, it's plugged in. You got power to it. It's running your program. Great. What does that mean, though? Well, I need to hit my serial monitor to actually see what it means. Do you see it's actually taking data now? So it's showing me that the environment right now is at 24 degrees or 24.71 degrees Celsius. Nice. It's actually now capable of reading the temperature of the room. Can we look on here and just see how to adapt the amount of time that it's taking to it's printing the temperature every second or something. I want to know where on that line of, what line of code shows you
the time.
Okay, so let's look for it because it's different from the last one. Help me out. And if you think you got it, edit it and then change it. Okay, so where are you seeing delay 1000 at? Okay. Yeah, line number 33, he's showing us that it says delay 1000. Doesn't that sound familiar? Delay 1000 milliseconds. If I wanted to change that to every 5 seconds, then I would change it to 5000. That's a simple way of learning how to modify. And students, they just make these little tiny changes. They see it causes their program to change, and it's just one little thing that causes them to say, hey, I can kind of learn how to do this. Now, if I don't want it to say degrees or DEGC, what if I wanted to just say degrees? Or what if I wanted to say Celsius?
Line 24, possibly.
I would say line 31. Do you see how it has parentheses?
Well, yes.
Degrees C. Why don't we just change that to Celsius? Stop simulator. Stop the simulator, and then you can change the code. Yeah. So think of what you've ever seen those in function. They're called function machines. And like you see, like, so you put something in, it does some work, and then it kicks out an answer, an output, input, output. So anytime that you see a parentheses, that's a function. And what they're saying is, here's a command, this is my function, here's my input or output. So it's going to do something with that, depending on the command. And you'll notice that a lot.
Did we already learn that?
No, that's something that we're kind of discussing as we're looking at code. Yeah. Okay, so it's just, and you'll see right here, return function of a function. So it's a nested function. So it's kind of neat. All right, so before I can ask you guys to go further, I need you to go back and change your delay, line 33. Make it 1,000. We don't want it to be anything else other than 1,000 for our future, the next step. We want them back at 1,000. So go back and edit that to make it say 1,000. It doesn't matter to me if you leave this as degrees Celsius or write the word Celsius. I'm sorry? Oh, okay. That was on line 31. I could change that right here on line 31. I can write the word Celsius. And then upload and run. And you'll see that it's going to start saying Celsius. Do you see that on the serial monitor? And it doesn't matter to me if you leave it as Celsius or DEGC, it's up to you. But let me move on to the next step, because this is the beginning. We're now able to analyze the temperature. I want to now start to learn how to respond to that. So how can I go and say, if it's a certain temperature, then do something like your thermostat does. That's exact the job of a thermostat. It says, if the temperature goes beyond this setting, then change, which we call thresholds. So if our temperature goes beyond a certain threshold, then do something. And if I go back to my presentation, I actually tried to document this for later use. I actually want to, and let me go down to the actual step. So end of first stage, we're done. We've already got a temperature reading, so we're done with the first stage. The second stage is to learn how to use what we call conditional statements. If something's happening, then do something. If it's raining outside, then your feet are gonna get wet, right? You know, if it's a holiday, then Disneyland is packed. Those are conditional statements. So what I want to do is I want to add an LED, which is just a light bulb. It's a light, you know, it's just a little tiny light that we have in our inventor's kit. I want to add an LED, and in order to make that LED work, I have to include what's called a resistor, and I'll explain that in a second. But let's go ahead and go back into the auto, the electronics lab in Circuits.io. And let me close down the editor. We're not going to mess with that right now. We're just going to minimize it by just clicking the button. I need to add an LED and a resistor. So can you find LEDs and resistors on your components page? So you'll notice there's an LED RGB. It's got four legs. That will complicate things a lot because you can now change that one to any color you want. But do you see how it has four legs? We have a lot more wiring to do. We're not going to mess with that. We're going to turn on a regular wire. We've done in one of the kits, one of the things they actually allow you to change the color. It's clear and it changes different colors. But we're not going to mess with that. Let's keep it simple to just say, if it gets to a certain temperature, turn this light on. So I'm going to grab it and just drop it somewhere on my breadboard. We'll worry about that later. I also need to get a resistor. So I'm going to type in the word resistor. And I see it right here. I'm going to grab this resistor, and I'm going to just drop it somewhere as well. I don't need to see where they're plugged in right now. I'm just going to just make sure they're on my breadboard for now.
Do I need to modify the resistance?
Yep, we're going to have to modify resistance. We're going to have a conversation about that first. But there's where we're at. All right. What I want to do is kind of lay out the problem that we were having yesterday and kind of discuss the scenario with you guys. If I'm using this, let me zoom it in so you can see it. If I'm trying to send power to this LED, these LEDs operate with very small amounts of electricity. That's why they're so, you know, they're used for a lot of things nowadays. Most lights in classrooms or on headlights, they use them for a lot of things because they're really efficient and they last a long time, which is nice. But there's one way to shorten the lifespan of these things, and that's to put too much power to overload them. So if you put too much power into them, then they will burn out. And one of the nice things is that we can actually do is we can actually practice that here, and we can change the amount of resistance here. If you click on the resistor, you'll see that it says resistance, and it says and it says K, which is 1,000 ohms. I'm going to just change this to just ohms, where it's just, it looks like an upside down horseshoe, right? And we'll worry about that later, but I wanted to just show you guys how you're going to edit the values of that. Now, what I want to do, escape, I want to plug some power into this LED. And before I do that, do you see, let me zoom in so you can see it. Table reps, I need you guys to make sure you really see this. There's two sides. Do you notice that one leg is bent? In your actual box, it does have a little extra tab on it, but one leg will be longer than the other. So how do you know which one's positive, which one's negative? In this case, the bent one, which is your anode, that's going to be the one we'll use as positive. So we're going to want to send a power signal into that. I'll talk about that in a second. And the other side is your cathode, which is your ground. So let me look at how I'm going to make this work. Everybody that's here, the way that we have it set up on our program is we're going to use digital 8. So D8, I'm going to run a power cord off of that. This is actually going to send an electronic signal, which is the same as power. And I'm going to just plug it into the rail that has my anode connected. Actually, I don't like the way this is set up right here. I'm going to delete this one and redo it again. Watch what I'm doing. Same thing, but I'm going to move it to the bottom. I'm going to make it go all the way around and plug it into the bottom. Explain in a second. And I'm going to put it down here. So actually, yeah, let's put it down here on the very bottom. So this one is on 22, so I made sure I put it on 22 over here. They're not connected yet. That's what the resistor will do. The resistor will connect the two. And then ground is just any ground. So I'm going to just grab the rail that's grounded, which is up the top part for me. And I'm just going to connect the ground. Here's what I'm doing. And try to make sense of this for you on your own as well. I need to make sure that I have a circuit. I know that this temperature sensor is working. We've already proven that it works. I ran the code. I know it's reading data. But I haven't checked this light. So what I want to do is just kind of problem solve this really quickly. Does this light sensor have a connection where it's going to get power from the Arduino? Do you see it? Like, map it out right here. Do you see D8? It's wrapping around. It goes over here into this 22. And then the resistor is bridging these two sides. Do you agree that this is going to get power from this red cable going through that resistor? You guys see that? Okay. Then the only other thing that I have to do is make sure that there's a ground, an active side that's grounded to the other leg. So that will give me my circle, my circuit. Now, the only thing that I need to do here is actually go and find out what kind of code I'm going to use to make that thing light up. Well, I want to introduce something to you guys because I can show you what the code is, but I think what's more important is teaching you guys how to locate this information on your own. The very first program that you used in your book details how to wire an LED, but also it gives you some code. I just want to show you guys that it explains how to use the resistor, how to plug in an LED. So that's all there. But what I want to do is ask you to go back to your presentation. And I am on slide 19. On slide 19, there's a little animation right here. And it says, this is going to link you to example one of the sketch. I don't want to copy and paste this, but I want to show you guys is that example one on how to light up an LED is right here on the screen. And I just want to show you guys a couple of key pieces of code that will help you understand what to do. So watch with me really quickly. I'm going to click it and just open it up. I know I'm looking at it because it says SIK example one sketch. Take a minute and look at all the stuff that's been highlighted on this program. Just read it yourself. You'll see that there's some yellow highlighting, some red highlighting. This will help you understand the code that we're about to put in. In particular, it's important that we review this program because look, do you see how it says pin mode 8 output? That's telling me that we want to add this pin mode 8 into the section that says void. Oops, my mouse is off. void setup. In the section that says void setup, I'm going to have to include this so that way it says, hey, you're going to turn on a pin which is connected to 8, digital 8 you guys saw on the actual program earlier. And then there's these parts that say digital write high, digital write low. Do you understand what digital write high, digital write low do? Yeah, they're going to turn a light on. Digital write high means turn on the LED. Digital write low means turn it off. So those are two pieces of information that are going to be useful to me. I'm going to just now say, let's go ahead and copy paste the actual code. I've set it up so you don't actually have to just add stuff. So let's go down a little bit. There's also a conditional statement that we'll use, and it's called, it's coded right here. I have it written down. So if you use this if, then, else, you'll see that it says, if the temperature is 40 degrees or higher, turn on the light, or else, turn the light off. So we'll use that on our code. Yeah, so what we're going to do is I actually have the code for you, so you can just delete everything you have with the additions. And what we'll do is we'll just take this on page, on your slide, page number 26. Yeah, so click on that one, and it'll help you. I yesterday there was some confusion. They were like, where do I add it? So I said, let me just put the whole entire program there. And let's review this program once you've copy-pasted it. I could have went to my code editor and added those extra pieces to it, but what I found was the time element, and also there was some confusion on how to add those to it. So I'm saying let's just copy paste that code and let's just study the code and make sure that we understand what it shows with those changes. Hey, right now this code on the code editor, when I went back over here after I copied it, I go to code editor. This is the code that runs the temperature sensor only. I need to remove this. So highlight the whole thing, backspace, delete it, blank space, right? Copy paste. And now I have the new code with some changes onto it. Will you just quickly examine those extra pieces that I've added? Do you see what it shows? Pin mode 8? You understand why I put that there? Okay. And then go down to the void loop. Do you see some additional pieces on there? I want to highlight the section 32 through 36. So if it gets high and then you turn on something and it goes down, it will still stay on. So you have to say if, then, or else. So you have to include both of those statements. So we're just trying to interpret some of the code, right? I'm not trying to teach you coding today, just interpreting some of that information. All right, how do I check to see if this program's working? Okay, so the serial monitor is there, I agree, but it actually isn't doing anything because I haven't uploaded a run or I haven't started simulator, right? So start the simulator. Successfully compiled. It shows that it's reading the temperature. It was doing that already, but what about... Okay. So you get this, but here's what I want to start off by saying is that we had this concern yesterday about this LED blowing up. The resistor being there, as long as we have a resistance that is bigger than 200, so it should be about 200 to 300 ohms. Remember, not kiloohms, but ohms. So you have to stop the simulator. Oh, actually, I think I can do it while the simulator is running. Let me go and put in 220, which is standard, I think. Ah, look it. It actually turns it on. If I stop the simulator, you can see the contrasting colors. Start, stop. Turns off. Nice. So your resistors, right, yeah. And you'll notice that too. That's a great point. Hey, if you want to really explain what a resistor does, have your students start at 100 and then see what happens. Well, then have them go a little bit higher, 150. And then start asking them the questions like, what's the brightest I can make that bulb, and have them vary the numbers. Well, your box only has one type of resistor, and it's like 320. Exactly. So it's just going to, yeah, so it's just going to be 320, and that's what you got. I started the simulator, and it was broken. Like it's saying, that when I highlight over it, too much power is going through this. This is only meant to hold 20 milliamps, but I'm putting too much power into it, right? So I select the resistor. And I'm going to actually change this from 1 to 220.
When I click on the resistor, that 220 window
doesn't pop up. Okay, so it's possible that you are, let me try and go from here outside. It still pops up here on mine. So maybe you're not clicking on the resistor. If you are, sometimes, and I'll be honest with you. Okay, it worked. So here's what I was going to say is that sometimes the software and your actual computer aren't updated. It's cloud-based, so it's got a... There might be a lag, and it could be the computer itself, because we had those problems yesterday, and I know we did it right, but it still wasn't working. So that being said, Hey, so here's one thing that I want to show you. There's one last piece of this step two that we haven't finished. What if, because I said conditionally, what if it's hotter than 15 degrees? What if it's not hotter than 15? But it just automatically turns on. What I want to do is actually test it to see if this conditional statement works or not. Toggle the temperature of the sensor and see if it turns on or off. Think about it. This is a temperature sensor in the virtual world. There's no way it's taking readings from your computer. So it will allow you to toggle if it's cold or hot in a room. So when it's too cold in here, it turns off. You saw it turn off when it's too cold. But then it's starting to get hot. The kids came back from lunch. Everyone was playing basketball. It's 100 degrees in your room. And it recognizes that, hey, it's getting hot. And pretty soon it's going to stink, right? You're all there with me. All right. So that's the next phase of this. Now, up to this point, we have almost, I mean, that's what a thermostat does, isn't it? It regulates the air. It gets a setup. But the next phase of this would be something like, well, what happens after the temperature gets to a certain a level of heat? What is the next phase of an air conditioner?
It maintains.
It turns on, right? So we have a fan turn on. We can actually include a fan on here. And now it's not an air conditioning unit, but it's a fan, a motor. So if you go and add, let's stop the simulator first. We can add a component here. And I'm going to just type in motor. And these are DC motors. In electronics, DCs are the cheapest. And you can wire them one way or the other, and they work both directions. So you can't mess up motors in that sense. I mean, you can mess them up, but. So I'm going to type in motor. Now, there's all these different motors. The one that I like actually has a fan blades on it. I like this one because it has fan blades on it. We would keep building these extensions. We would just go from here, and we would say, OK, I can add a motor here. Now, the same way that I said digital 8 to make sure that the power goes on, I need another digital power source to add to my fan. So I need to find out what, you know, what section it is. And I believe I've wired it already onto the, is it wired on here? It's not wired on here. I can actually just pull it up. I have it on this machine. Let me show you really quickly. I'll load it so you can see the wiring. We won't take any more time on this because I want to show you guys the physical phase of this is where we're going to plug in the LCD screen. If you look on my screen really quickly, table rips, if you want to power this fan the right way, the power, the anode, is going into digital 7. Digital 7. So that's how you wire it. Digital 7 and ground. It does matter. Well, the programming, because remember on the actual program, it says digital right 7, digital right 8. You need to make sure those numbers line up right. So I won't go into the fan part. I'll just leave it at that for now. And it's saved. You have an account here, so you can actually go further on this. What I want to do is show you guys that it's nice. And you know, for the most part, these analog switches are kind of like the old dials that you might have seen in an old classroom where you just turn it and it sets yourself. But nowadays, you actually have like digital thermometers with digital readouts. And you actually have a digital screen in your SIK. We also have a digital screen on this. And I would like to show you guys how to include the digital screen on this. So this is the last phase, which I labeled as step three. I won't throw it all out at you at once, but I'm going to ask you guys to look in your SIK book because that's where the LCD screen is at. So if you find LCD screen on table of contents, where is it at? Page 77, yeah, go there. Have that actively open in front of you because this thing uses like 8, 9, 10 cables. I'm going to recommend that we try to kind of push some of the stuff off the side, or at least say, if I'm going to use the LCD screen, then I want to make sure that these wires are kind of pushed back some over here, so that way they're not in the way. You know what I'm saying? So we want to try and clear out some of the space behind here because with 8 or 9 wires going there, it might be a little difficult to see. So before I do that, let me give you some comforting words that this diagram is going to be your best friend for the next couple of minutes because you're all going to kind of be at a self-paced. I'm going to just walk around and try and help people. But this diagram shows you how the LCD is going to be connected. So what I'll do is I'll add the LCD to components first. So here's where I'm at, components. And I'm going to type in, I believe it's registered as 16x2 LCD. Maybe it just says LCD. Perfect, 16x2, it's there. It's the same exact LCD screen that you have. I'm going to drop it down here. And one last piece of helpful hint. Let me minimize that. take a look at this LCD screen. I would zoom in on your screen the most that you can and just focus on making sure that your wiring here lines up with whatever it is that you're doing. So take a few minutes and try and plug those in. Stand up, stretch your legs for a minute as well, get some air, because this is going to be an independent piece, but you need some movement. Someone was asking, can I get rid of the LED screen, the LED bulb? Yes, you can get rid of this if you want to clean things up. But with the screen, you don't really need to have a light bulb light up. You're welcome to keep it on there. The code will still recognize it, but it will also not do anything if it's not there. So it won't complete that part of the circuit. It'll still work without it. Let me just get everyone to kind of just look up front for a second. Let me give a final message, and then I'm going to ask that we clean up and stuff. But if I can just talk to you really quickly, I want to say a few words, and then we'll move on. So first of all, I want to say I recognize that it's a challenge, and I do recognize your struggles that you're having. I was in the same spot. Okay, I did go to college and learn how to program, but a lot of this new electronic stuff is new to me as well. So I went through the same pains that you're going through, and I'm not going to push that. But what I do want to say that I recognize that you're also at the front of this. You guys are the ones that are going to be leading the charge to bring this kind of stuff to the kids. What I envision students having in the future is every grade level having one of these things. These are $20 boards. And if kids can have one of these things and use them for science, use them for math, and then build them into presentation pieces for English, and so we only create the base. They're going to be the ones doing the ceiling. So if we can just introduce this stuff to them, they're going to be doing so much more than we would have thought of doing. And I promise you it's going to happen. Whether it happens here, or if it happens in Bakersfield City, or Panama, it's going to happen eventually. People are going to jump on board and realize the power of this stuff. What I would like to know and like to see happen is Lamont leading the charge and bringing this to your staff. So I recognize that it's a struggle, and I recognize the challenges, the hurdles you're having. My recommendation is to always start here and then transfer that to the physical. And like I was showing some of the people in the front, this is where you want to get to. I mean, this is what you guys have on your board, right? It's really daunting to look at this thing, but if you've already gone through and you've already seen where the temperature cables go to, when you do stuff like that, you start to look at this in different light. You say, oh, well, that wire goes to the temperature sensor and that wire goes to the LED, and you start to really take this apart and it makes more sense to you. And that's the same reason why in the military and boot camp, they make someone take apart a gun a million times and put it back together. You know, that mentality where you're just doing things and you slowly start to discover these pieces to it. And I know that this can happen. Well, these can be created, and you can plug in power sources, like a 9-volt battery pack to this thing, and you can have this hanging in your classroom, and kids can go over there and check the temperature or the humidity level or whatever it is that you have it set up to do. These things are there, and it's active, and I would love to see Lamont doing this stuff. Now, I know SKMP is finished, and most of this work that we've done is through them, but I've already mentioned this to Joelle, that I would be more than willing to come back and do some additional pieces to this. This is the very beginning. What I would like to show the next time, if I presented the opportunity, is to actually create a water pump activated, so you can actually do an automatic watering system to a plant. So you have a small plant in your office or in your classroom. Well, you can set this kind of thing up to where it checks it daily, and if it gets water levels too low, whatever, it turns on a water pump. And that's nothing more than turning on a fan. It's just a different pump. So I can show you guys some of these things. The LCD screen, definitely we overshot on that one. I know that that's a lot of extra wiring, but it's possible, and it's really neat to see stuff like that when you can have those readouts. So I thank you for your time, and I definitely thank you for your patience, and I know that this is just the beginning step, and I would love to continue working with you guys beyond SKMP. All right, so thank you. I appreciate it. Yeah.